I'm going to you talk to you first on the Hima lifeboat. You can hear me, sir. Is that all right?
We have. It is visible, sir.
It's not there. As Ragini, you can hear me. Ragini is also muted.
Sir, I can hear you, but we cannot hear the sound in the video, I think.
Now.
So that sound icon is there, no, in the video?
I can't hear you. One second.
Yes, sir.
Now you can hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you, but is there any sound in the video?
Yes, there was, but I've cut off the sound.
We are calm and peaceful.
Okay, so then so we can hear you, but...
Sometimes
okay.
Problems occur.
I'll start off again. Now, basically, when once in a while you get in trouble, it breaks, you have a subluxated lens sitting, what do you do? I'm going to show you 2-3 methods which are a little different. One of them is what we call as the Hima lifeboat. It is very similar to the Amar method. And the whole idea behind it is that you take a lens, you put it behind, and then you can proceed forwards. There are no financial implications in this video whatsoever.
FECO.
Now, FECO is normally a calm and peaceful procedure, but sometimes when you're operating, it suddenly breaks in the lower quadrant, and you know that with these huge pieces lying there, you're going to be in trouble. You can see vitreous coming out, which I'm cutting off at the side here. And we know that we are going to be there. At this point, the surgeon is in a quandary and often in his worst nightmare. Now what to do? Because you try anything funny and it will drop. Let me show you a new device. It is like a raft and hence its name. It's a Hima lens, basically a Hima contact lens in which you punch out a 9.5 millimeter lens. A regular plus 5 diopter contact lens which is available in a sealed form. All you need to do is to put it into your injector. No great show, no great problems. And you inject it inside the eye, lying behind the bag, which is behind the fragments which have broken. So this is the Hima lens, as you can see it coming out here now. And all that you now need to do is inject it to one side of the lens. Please see carefully. All that you now need to do is inject it along one side of the lens. That is your Hima lens, 9.5 millimeter plus 5 diopter lens. Why plus 5 diopters? Because it gives it stability. Then you take the fragments and you stack them in. So once the lens opens up, you take your fragments and just put them forward. A 9.5 lens sits very peacefully on the iris. No chance of any fragments falling behind. You don't have to bother. It costs you almost nothing, which it costs maybe about 50 rupees for the lens. And you can then do a slow motion FECO over the surface. You can see the edges of the lens here. So you know that the fragments are now sitting on the lens. They are not going to go anywhere. They are going to be absolutely stable. Once you remove the final fragments that you do, then you can remove the lens. This is the lens sitting on. All you have to do is to hold the lens with the forceps, tug it out, it just comes out. There's no big noise about it, no big shakes. And just show you the lens now onto the cornea so you know what is the size and how it looks really. It's a 9.5 millimeter refined punch which you use and punch out the plus 5 diopter lens. This is the lens. I'm opening it on the cornea and just showing you so you know what it looks like. That's your lens. Now you can then proceed to eliminate it. Now I'm going to show it in the short animation. It's a flexible Hima concave lens. Nothing much to worry about. All you need to do with this lens is you put it into your injector and you inject it. But the critical thing which I'm going to demonstrate to you is that you have to inject along the sides. If you inject on top, you're in trouble because the fragments won't come on top. And when you inject it, you fold it over, you know, like a man folding his arms over. And then you fold it and inject it. It goes through any injector which is available to you. There's absolutely no problem about it. Nothing very great about it. This is injected through a standard injector which is available anywhere. So you inject it to one side and then you use a repositor and unroll the lens. Then you move the fragments onto the lens. Once you move them onto the lens, then removing it is very simple. There's really no hassles, no great difficulty. One by one, the fragments can go. Slow motion phaco. The lens sticks onto the surface. It does not move. You cannot drop fragments inside. So you are absolutely safe in what you are doing. And you can just proceed. After you finish the procedure, all you have to do is to hold the fragments and take them out. Again, really no hassles, no difficulty. And then at the end of it all, of course, you simply remove the lens. You can either use a hook and remove the lens or you use a forceps and remove the lens. And once it is removed, all you have to do is to proceed. I'm going to show you once again so that it enters and you know exactly how it is done. Once again, we are operating, get a break. Lower part is broken, vitreous pouring out. You try any funny games, you know, the lens is going to sit on the bottom and your retina friend is going to thank you for a free case. Now, the next step which you do is inject your lens at the side. Very important, inject at the side. Make a little jaga and inject it. Then take a repositor and sweep it below the fragments. Sweep it below the fragments. Once you have swept them below the fragments, there is absolutely no hassle. It lies steady onto the iris and you can then subsequently do a phacoemulsification and remove the final fragments. So when you are stuck, you don't have to do any gymnastics. You just need a contact lens lying at the side, which everybody has. And you can then save the procedure with no difficulty, no hassles, no problems. Once the cortex is gone, only the nuclear cortex is left over, which you can do either remove it by a viscoelastic viscous aspiration, or you can just do a small core vitrectomy and clear it off. So this is the lens just to demonstrate to you. This is a very easy method. And then subsequently, a simple IA gets rid of the problem. Since you have not disturbed the vitreous face at all, and you only move the fragments forward, it works well. What we normally recommend is just a visco dissection. And then you can inject your lens in and place it anterior to the capsular bag which you have made. So your lens can then fit in. So you have saved the day by a very simple, innovative, simple device. Requires nothing. It should be in your operation theater in every case. Thank you very much. A posterior polar cataract. What is a way in which you make sure that you will never have trouble? I call it the positive pressure float technique. Stay with me. You'll find it interesting. The problem has always been that with the slightest hydro dissection, the phaco fluid inflow, the posterior capsule gives way, dropping the nucleus and the vitreous. How do you manage this? The method of managing it is simple. You balance the inflow into the posterior and anterior chamber so that the posterior capsule stays static. So there's no chance of a break. It supports it even when the break is there, it enables to support it. We have always wondered how you could do this little method. A simple three-way connection between the phaco handpiece and the fluid line to the posterior chamber. Be with me. It sounds a little odd, but it works, and that is what you need to do. It's a short animation to explain how this procedure works. From the phaco handpiece, you have a line, a two-way line, with a little stopcock in the middle. Normally what happens is you put in the phaco and the piece drops. What we need to do is to balance it. How do you balance it so that it will not drop? You balance it by injecting fluid from the side. But the whole balance secret is how much fluid should run simultaneously with the phaco. So you connect a three-piece handpiece to a little bung. To a little bung at the side, and you connect it onto a thing which goes into the back near the posterior sclera. So you have the moment you turn the phaco on, simultaneously little drops will fall out from your point here. Notice the drops, they fall tip, tip, tip. It should be at this speed. So what do? You first put a little, this is your posterior polar. You see the edges are crenellated. When you have a crenellated posterior polar, that thing is going to give you trouble. So first put in this unit in the back. So that now you got fluid flowing in. Put nothing into it. Now we just start off with the regular surgery. You do your phaco as you would normally do. You do your rexus as you would normally do. No great problems here about it. We are going normal. There's absolutely no difficulty and no headaches. Until, and you decide now to do a little bit of hydro. And unfortunately, now you notice that the edge here, it is starting to give way. So now you know, okay, abhi meri shaan aane wali hai. Still, we are stable, so there is no problem. Now you turn on that unit. Now it is pumping fluid in behind at the same time as your phaco. Notice the capsule, it stays static. It doesn't move backwards at all. So your lens stays, if anything, a little forward. You will notice the chamber will shallow a little, but that is quite okay. There's nothing to worry. Your inflow is going in from behind, which is more than enough to balance your pressure of it. You can do your eye and get away. So it's a positive pressure which is going in from behind to stabilize it. And though the capsule is broken, there is nothing flowing in or out because you have balanced it out. In the end, you simply take it out and then you can put your lens in. So it's a very simple, easy method in which you balance the inflow and outflow so that it stabilizes by itself. And then after that, all you have to do is you inject your lens in and the problem ends there. So this is what we call as a balanced inflow-outflow system. Even on a break, it stabilizes it and the problems will go away. It is something which we have started working recently. It fluidically balances and it gives excellent results. Once your balance is there, as I said, remember the drops are falling in the fluid which is going into the back, into the posterior chamber. It's just tap, tap, tap. It gives devastating good results with literally no risk and no problems. Thank you very much for allowing me to share this video. Okay. Now, this is known as sclerocorneal transiridial suturing. For some unaccountable reason, no one has thought of this earlier. Daljeet Singh had shown us that the peripheral retina iris never moves and it remains stable. If that is so, there's no reason why we can't use this. I'm going to show you a short animation to show you how this system works. Essentially, what you're going to do is suture it in a manner so that it is transferred through cuts in the corneoscleral zone and the suture is then buried inside the corneoscleral zone. So there's no flap to be made, no gullies to be done, nothing of the sort. And the lens ultimately will sit in this fashion, lying inside. Now, when you fit these lenses, you always fit them in the same pattern with the 7-degree backwards. It never touches the iris and is stable. Now, just to show you how this system works, you're going to put the lens inside. It doesn't make a difference whether you do it as a primary or as a secondary procedure. All you have to do is just open up the conjunctiva a little on both sides and dry it out. Now these are literally, as you know, I'm a little bit of a lazy surgeon. So I like to have systems which work fast for me. I'm using a diamond blade, but literally anything can be utilized. You are required to make an opening, which is about 0.5 millimeters. This is using a diamond blade, which is set at 0.4. All you have to do is to make two little cuts on the side at the sclerocorneal junction. Very simple, no hassles, no difficulties. No making flaps, no dissecting flaps, nothing. Just two little half cuts through the sclera. Having done that, you take your needle, put it at the edge and then put it vertically through the iris. And on the other side, in that same little opening which you have made, you railroad it out again using a 26 gauge needle. So you railroad it out again. So you have made two transiridial cuts through which you have placed your suture and you remove the needle. Normally we would make a flap and then put the suture below the flap and then put the flap back and then use glue, etc., etc., etc. Here you do nothing. Just make your cuts at the side and take your needle out. Next step, of course, is very simple. You take your lens, you take your suture out, and simply attach it to your lens. Here I'm putting a Raynor lens, which is what I originally had planned on doing, but any lens can be utilized. It doesn't make any difference. You just flip your suture through twice, and then you sneak the lens in again. Tighten the sutures on top, so you've got your two sutures, one side, one on the other side, and you introduce your lens in. Cut it off and suture it in. Big advantages, you've done nothing at the side, no flaps to be made, nothing more to be done. All you have to do is you can increase the incision a little, which I've done, more than enough, because it's a Raynor lens, it squeezes through comfortably through a 5 millimeter, 4.5 millimeter opening. You just have to push it in a little and it'll sneak its way in. A lot of these lenses just need to be squeezed in. You don't need to open the incision bigger. Now comes the very interesting part, which I want you to notice, because this is how the whole secret of the procedure works. How do you suture it in now? The method of suturing it in is again as critical as the method by which you are doing it. I had to try a number of times before I finally worked out this method, but it's a simple technique. All you need to do is to pass your needle in the depth of the incision that you made. You remember the little groove which you made? Pass it in the depth of the incision and take it out again. The whole idea is that you will bury your suture into the depth of the sclerocorneal incision which you have made, and then you can just simply suture one limb to the other limbs. One is two loops, one is a single loop. It doesn't make any difference. You just suture it in and just tie it over and suture it in. Once you have done that, you do the same thing onto the opposite side. But the important step is, remember, your lens, and you work the knot in. Important step is go along the length of the incision. Incision has to be at least 3 millimeters long, and just go along the depth of the incision and take it out. So that when you come out, there's two loops, one from out, one from in, and you just tie and suture them. All you need to do is to make sure that the suture buries itself into the depth of the sclerocorneal incision which you have made. You no longer have to do anything anymore. Just nick it on both sides, get rid of it. The little conjunctival flap which you have made doesn't have to be even touched. Just move it in a little, and that is all that is required. So this is one method in which you can get away without doing anything. All you have to do is just work it in a little, and that's it. Next day, your eyes are perfect. You have made no incision, no problem, nothing. Just work your, make sure your knots are in, and just pull your conjunctiva up and leave everything as it is. Nothing more to be done. So this is one of the easy ways. I call it as a trans-iridial suturing. It works beautifully, has no problems. The lens lies comfortably. There's no hassles at all. It's a very simple method. You should try it tomorrow, and it works well.